I hope everybody's enjoying the conference. I'm Ajade. I'm a first-year MBA, and I'm proud to present Ms. Michelle Florendo. She's a Stanford undergrad engineer, and she's a Haas alum for her MBA program. She was an engineer by training, and now she's a career coach, and she uses her decision engineering as part of her coaching technique. I would like to present Michelle Florendo, CEO and founder of What If I Could, LLC.
Thank you. So I'm here to present Career Crossroads, Harnessing the Power of Us. And as Ajita said, I'm a former engineer. I studied industrial engineering and decision engineering at Stanford, and it's part of how I do my work. Essentially, if people try to figure out, like, how did I go from being an engineer to being a management consultant, to being in brand management, getting my MBA, and doing this, it's because I'm a maximizer. Like, I love maximizing things. I love optimization. And ultimately, in the work that I do every day, I get to maximize the contribution that my clients get to make in the world. I find that the people who I work with are really great at what they do, sometimes too good, and then they find themselves at a crossroads where they realize, okay, this is fine, but is there something else that I could be doing? So I'm here to talk a little bit about how I do this work, but really, this workshop is not about me. This workshop is going to be about all of you. I was really excited when the organizers approached me and asked me to come back. This is my fourth time speaking, I think, at a Women in Leadership conference. And when they told me that the theme was the power of us, I thought, oh, wow. Like, this is something that is really powerful, right? And so one of the intentions that I always have when I run these workshops at this conference is that, no doubt, many of you have heard very inspiring speeches. Yes, like the one right before this. Maybe attended really thought-provoking panels. Yes, okay. This is going to be an interactive session, and so don't be afraid to speak up. And I find that sometimes at these conferences, there's so much going on that it's hard to find time to sit and reflect on the things that you've been hearing, the things that you've been learning, and then also reaching out and connecting to the other wonderful people who are here, right? And so that's part of what I want to accomplish in the next 90 minutes, to give you some space to think about, again, why are you here? What brought you here? What is it that you're looking for? What is it that you hope to get out of the end of the day? Who do you hope to meet, and how might they help you? And not only that, how can you help others? Because again, the power of us comes from each one of us offering what we can offer and asking for what we need. Make sense? Okay. I feel like I've done a little bit of talking. I want to get a sense of who's in the room and what brought you here. So can I get a few brave souls to tell me what brought you here today and specifically to this session? Yes, up there.
Thank you. So I've been in my particular career role for quite a while, and you know, I love coming to these sessions and kind of talking to people and networking. And what I'm finding is that as you kind of are in the early part of your career, there's a lot of growth. You have good mentors. And then you get to a certain place where all of a sudden you start competing with the men who used to be your mentors or sponsors, and they no longer find you interesting to promote, but they want you're now their competition. And so I'm trying to understand from a career perspective, is there a different strategy I need to employ now that I'm a little more mature in my career than I did when I was younger and wasn't kind of competing with a certain subset of people? And I don't know if this is the right workshop for that, but that's why I was here. It's kind of how to reinvent that story and look at it a little differently.
Got it. Well, I can say that, again, this workshop is not going to be about me giving you all of my advice. This workshop is going to be about how is it that you can leverage the collective wealth of wisdom that's in this room, and also elsewhere on campus, because I know there's a networking reception later in the day too, right? To get some of those questions answered. But thank you for sharing. Anyone else would like to share? Right up here, and then we'll go there.
Hi, my name's Mansi. I'm literally at a career crossroads right now because I have two job opportunities that I'm trying to figure out long-term what suits me best in terms of work-life balance and in terms of career opportunities. So I'm hoping to get some insights here.
And then I think I saw a hand over here.
Oh. Hi, and my name is Natalie. I'm also at a career crossroads where I'm coming towards the end of a one-year fellowship and need to decide what my career is going to be and what direction I'm going in next.
Let's see, down here, and then we'll go to the front.
Hi, my name is Kiari. I'm also at the career crossroad, but my what I'm trying to learn from this workshop is trying to understand how do I prevent the perceptions of other people of what you do now prevent you from going to the directions that you want to do. So right now I'm in health and fitness, and I have backgrounds in sales, but I want to go into sales within health and wellness. But I got a lot of perception that people trying to put me in the box say, like, oh, you have a lot of health and fitness. So they want me to go in that, keep putting me in that directions.
How can you present yourself in a way that helps you move in the direction you want to go?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll do two more. So here and there.
Hello.
Yeah.
I'm Neha, and I'm an engineer. And there is an interesting thing I would like to share. I started my career as the only woman in a switchboard manufacturing plant that had 500 plus employees. And I started in engineering jobs, have been managing delivery and delivery of technical projects. Now, just last year, I read this book, Jack Welch's book, which is, you know, find your area of destiny. Find what do you really want to do in life, what excites you. And then after that, I've been thinking, okay, now 20 years, should I look at something else where I can help people or maybe, you know, learn from other leaders and see what difference you can make. So that's how it's, that's the thought that brings me here.
Okay. So I'm Julia. I work in finance, and when we talk about robots, you know, disintermediating people from their jobs is literally happening in my industry. I go for women-only networking events, and I see women in their 30s to their 50s who have just been laid off because their funds have bled, money. So I just want to learn about how, when your industry is structurally shrinking and you have to make a change, what are steps you can do to think about what's best next? Yeah.
Okay. Got it. So I want to acknowledge everyone for sharing what it is that they're trying to get out of this session, because I want to say that is one of the things that sometimes keeps people from being able to find the help that they need, right? Just being able to air what it is that they're looking for. So like I said, my intention in this workshop, as you can see, it's a pretty intimate environment. We're going to continue to share, is to help you understand how is it that you can get some of the your questions answered. How is it that you can connect with people effectively, have good conversations, and even get people to commit to sustained action or connection that'll help you move you forward down the path that you want to go down, right? Again, tapping into the power of us. But the thing is, what's interesting is that it isn't as if there's a wealth or a lack of knowledge out there. Sometimes it's a lack of being able to ask effectively. Has anyone had that experience? Like challenges trying to ask for help? Okay, so that's a bit of what we're gonna talk about today. I'm going to be talking through three major themes. So basically, what are some of the things that get in the way of people being able to find the help that they need, or also even give the help that they can offer in the ways that we connect, the ways that we have conversations, and the ways that we can commit to each other and supporting one another. All right? Okay. So one thing I want to do first is I want to give everyone here an opportunity to just quickly introduce yourself to the people around you. Again, there's going to be a lot of interactive exercises that I want you to start getting comfortable with one another. So go ahead and just take 2 minutes, introduce yourself to some of the people who are around you. And so I'm curious, what were some of the things that you learned about people just in that little bit of time? Did you learn people's names? Did you learn what do they do? I heard some no's, which is okay. Do you feel like you learned something more than that? Fewer yeses? Do you feel like you've learned how they might be able to help you? Not yet. Okay. So that's one of the things that I want to work on in this first exercise. It's interesting because, again, I feel like there's a lot of potential in this room, a lot of potential at this conference and this power of us. And again, not for lack of willingness to help, because raise your hand if you would love to be able to help someone in this room, if you can. Everybody. See, this is why I love coming to these conferences. Everyone wants to come, be helpful. It's amazing. All right, so everyone's willing to help someone else, go. There's laughter, right? Okay. Because something's missing, right? And so I want to illustrate this actually through a story. You may have heard or seen this on the internet. So there's a story about a speaker who had done an exercise where they were speaking at a conference and then they handed out a balloon to every single person, handed out Sharpies, asked each person to write their name on the balloon. And then they put all the balloons in a different room and then gave everybody 5 minutes to find their own balloon. How many people do you think found their balloon? No one. So then they switched tactics. They said, okay, just pick up a balloon. Pick a balloon at random, now go deliver it to their rightful owner. Within 5 minutes, everyone had their balloons. Now, what's interesting is the key thing that shifted was the way in which people were communicated and how they were communicating. If you think about it, in the first time, when they're just looking for their own balloon, you know, they know what they need, they're just trying to take care of it themselves. Maybe they might help someone, but really we're focused on our task. There wasn't really facilitated communication of, you know, what is it that I need, what have you seen? But in the second example, if you have someone else's balloon in a room full of strangers, you can't actually finish your task of delivering that to the owner without showing people what you have, right? Asking people, you know, what's your name, to try to figure out what they need. Do they need your balloon? And then in some cases, there's likely, because you've been communicating these things with everyone that you're interacting with, you might also get, oh, I just saw so-and-so, they're over there. Or I just saw that balloon, it's over there. Oops. And so one of the things that I'm passionate about is helping people rethink how is it that you initially connect with people so that you're communicating in a way that helps people understand not only what it is that you need and what you're looking for, but also how is it that you might be able to help. One of the things that we do in a personal branding intensive workshop that I lead is revamp how people introduce themselves. And to a degree, this may help the young woman who was talking about how do I, you know, introduce myself in a way that helps move me the way I want to go, as opposed to just like where I am, right? And so if you think about it, at these conferences, after you ask what people's names are, or you look at their name tag, there are two questions that often come up, right? What do you do, and what brings you here? What's great about these two questions, though, is that you can reframe how you think about it in order to think about how you might be able to help or ask for help. So in answering that first question, think about what details can you share that might help give others an idea of what you may be able to help them with. And so I advocate for thinking about how can you go beyond the what do you do and broaden what your potential impact can be. So for example, one of the things that you can do is talk about the things that you're passionate about. So I have a friend, she runs an online education program for Seth Godin, who's like this marketing guru guy. And she introduces herself as such. Hi, my name is Wes Kao. I run the Alt MBA for Seth Godin. And I'm really passionate about helping people understand how marketing can be leveraged in social change and social movements. It takes another 5-10 seconds, right? But it gives you a better perspective of what is it that she knows or what are the things that she may be able to help with, right? So you can think about how can you expand that to including one of your passions. Maybe you want to talk about your path, like to the one who was up there talking about how you've gotten to that point in your career and you're realizing, you know, what got you here may not be what gets you there, as Marshall Goldsmith says. And so if other people were to think about, well, how can I introduce myself with not only what do I do, but maybe what my path has been. Like I have a client who is a new mom re-entering the workforce. And so when people ask her, what does she do? She may say that, I'm a new mom re-entering the workforce. But I've also spent the past 10 years in management consulting, helping healthcare clients operationalize or scale their operations. I think another thing that you can do, aside from incorporating maybe your passion or your path into how you introduce yourself, is also think about, well, what is in my portfolio of how I spend my time? We are not only what we do from 9 to 5 or 9 to 7 or 9 to 12, depending on where you work. We often do other things, right? And so I have another friend, she's an exec in the human capital arm of HP, but spends a lot of time outside of that with women's organizations, and is on the leadership committee of Lean In Palo Alto and Watermark. And again, she introduces herself with those pieces as well because she knows that it gives people a better idea of how she can help. And so I'd advocate for everyone in this room to think about how might you shift or expand how you introduce yourself to share more about how you might be able to be helpful to someone. I'm going to go ahead and give you a minute to think about it, then I'm going to ask you to reintroduce yourself, maybe to the same people, maybe to other people, okay? Just a practice. All right, so go ahead, take a bit of time to think about what might that intro sound like, and then go ahead and try it out on someone. So I'm curious, what are some of the things, additional things, people may have learned about the people around them that they may not have learned the first time? Personal stories. Okay, what else? Okay, awesome. Broader sense of the direction she's going. Additional things. Lifestyle choices, right here. Skills rather than job titles. Career transitions. Right. Values identification, awesome. And I love, I think I saw that you had already exchanged cards, a good connection made there, great. It's interesting because what I love about this different way of thinking about how you introduce yourself is that also you get into deeper conversations. Is anyone here an introvert? Anyone here usually not like having to talk to strangers? I feel like a part of the reason why I love talking about this is because it makes it a whole lot easier to do exactly that if you have any resistance. If you think about networking from the perspective of, okay, instead of how do I put myself out there, instead, well, how can I share more about how I can help people, it feels a lot better, right? Okay, well, I'm glad to see that people were able to learn more about one another and hopefully learn more about either how people may help or what they're looking for as a result. Also, I forgot to put up here the second question, what brings you here? But I think you already got that. One of the things that you can share when someone asks that is, you know, more about what you're looking for, right? The more we can communicate about what we're looking for or what our broader story is, the better we're able to find matches between the help that we need and the help we can offer, right? But connections are just the beginning, right? Like, when you come to a conference like this, you may connect, you may meet people, maybe you meet people who will be useful to have an additional conversation with, right? And so that's another opportunity in which you can both offer and receive help. Like, how many people have had conversations with others that have been really inspiring? Keep your hand up if you've had conversations with people that have been really informational, like really enlightening. Raise your hand if you've had conversations that were really awkward. It happens. Again, like I said, one of the things that I want to do today is help us all move through some of the things that get in the way of being able to get help and offer help in the various ways in which it happens. And so when it comes to conversations, I hear this a lot. Yeah, right? I hate when the conversation gets awkward. It's funny, I had a recent client who came to me, and unlike some of my other clients, she already had her story down, she already knew what is it that she wanted to do, but her key struggle was this. Like, she had a network. She could make those, she was able to get those introductions. She was able to get on people's calendars. But then in the conversation, there would sometimes be that crest where she, you know, may have asked, oh, is there any job opportunities here? And the answer was no. And then this happened. So let's talk about how we can move through that. And why does this happen, right? So this happens because people sometimes don't know how they can continue to help you. Every year I do a talk over at Bolt to their international students in their LLM program, and I tell them about this thing that we have in the US called networking. And they almost don't believe me. What? You can reach out to someone you've never met before, ask for time in their calendar, and they'll talk to you? But it happens, right? Like, I think people here have had that happen to them. And the thing is, people do that because they want to be helpful. But in the midst of the conversation, if they don't understand how they can be helpful, then this happens. All right, so let's talk about how can we move past this. Well, help them be helpful. If you think about it, when you're having these conversations with people, oftentimes it's not just about one way that they can help you. It definitely is not going to be just that they can tell you if there are open jobs. You can probably find that out online sometimes. Although, yes, there is a hidden job market. I will acknowledge that. But there are a lot of other ways that people can help. And I find that it's useful to talk through them because, one, it helps you understand what are the different questions that you can ask or move through. And then also, if you're in the position of wanting to help someone, you can also think through, well, what are the different hats that I can wear in order to help them get to where they want to be? I know there's a lot of text on this slide. I usually don't like text-heavy slides, but I couldn't think of another way to do this. All right, so help them be helpful. There's a lot of different ways that people can be helpful and a lot of different roles they can play. I see some people taking pictures of slides. Actually, if you want a copy of these slides afterwards, I'll tell you how you can get them. You can download them online, okay? All right, so one of the things that people can be is a role model. You know, what is someone or who is someone that you may aspire to be, who has gone down the path that you want to go down. And so if you find that that's a hat that they might be able to wear, you'll want to ask them about, you know, what was their path? What does their current role look like? How did they make the decision to do what they're doing now? And what are the future options they're considering? If they're not a role model, or maybe you move through these questions and you're like, oh, okay, maybe there's a different way they can or want to be helpful. Another way to think about it is, are they an advisor? Are they someone who you can ask for advice from, simply just from their perspective, from their experience? Like if you encounter another person who may be at a similar point in their career, maybe facing similar challenges, you can enter into a dialogue about, well, how are you thinking through this? What are some of the parallel challenges you're seeing or the ways that you've moved through them? Sometimes people can be a maven, like someone who just is a source of information. And the thing is, they don't necessarily need to be an expert, because oftentimes you're trying to learn about things that you don't know yet. So they just need to know a little bit more than what you already know, right? So you might ask questions around, well, okay, what are some of the key industry trends that you're seeing, like given where you are? Or what are some of the other like key players and companies in this field? Who are your competitors? Who else should I be talking to? How do you stay on top of what's happening? What are some of the shifts that you've seen in the types of people they're looking to hire? What does your team and your function do? What are they responsible for? What are those people like? Or even, what does the process look like if I eventually want to work here? Aside from applying online, are there other avenues that I should be considering or taking advantage of? And then lastly, if you move through all of those different roles, just about everyone can be a connector. Just like everyone in this room can be a connector. Again, it's not just about what you know, it's also about who you know and who they know. That's part of what feeds into this power of us. No doubt, all of the different things that you may be looking for, the types of questions that you are seeking answers to, there's probably someone in this room who knows a good person for you to talk to. You just have to ask them the question. Do you know a person who, XYZ, works in this type of field, as it is at this level, has this much experience, or is struggling with this, maybe has this background? Again, part of accelerating people being able to find help and offer help is being able to ask the right questions. And so the next time that you're going to embark on a conversation or you're dreading, what if I encounter that awkward silence? Remember, there's a lot of different ways that you can take a conversation. And I'd actually advocate for you to take some time now. Again, interactive, very much live practice of things. We're gonna do like a think, pair, share type of exercise. So I'm gonna give you 2 minutes to brainstorm. What are all the different questions you could possibly ask someone to get the types of information or resources or connections that would help you move forward in what you're struggling with? Okay? So I'll give you 2 minutes, and then I might actually have people stand up, jumble around, and then share, and then we'll do a share out, okay? All right, so go ahead, take some time to brainstorm. For anyone who's really goal-oriented, if you need a goal, see if you can think of 10 questions. All right. If you're done brainstorming on your own, I encourage you now, okay, I know you've been sitting next to the same people for a while, but I'd say get up. Find someone else who you haven't spoken to yet. And just share some of the things that you've brainstormed. See if there's something that you can learn or something that they thought of that you didn't. So I got a great question from Neha that I figured I'd share with the group. First off, were people able to have good conversations around this? Useful tool for moving through the awkward, like, what can I ask? Okay. So, Neha, Neha asked a really great question. How is it that you know whether a person can be a role model or an advisor or a maven or a connector? Well, the thing is, part of it is before going into some of these questions, you'd likely want to do talk through some of this stuff, right? So being able to, again, the whole thinking about how to have different conversations about what do you do is meant to just be a seed for a greater conversation about, you know, people's paths, people's stories, their skills instead of their job titles, their values, their passions. And once you're able to have that conversation, then based on what you learn about the person, you may be able to discern what hats they might play here. And so, for example, if you get into the conversation and learn more about what their path may have been, and you're seeing similarities to yours, or at least the things that they may be considering in the future, and there may be alignment with what you're considering, you may be able to have role model or advisor types of discussions with them. Or maybe if you're in a transition space, trying to go from one industry or function to another, and you find that someone has expertise in that exact space, then that may be a signal that you can think, okay, what are some of the questions I can ask them that might tap into their like maven hat? And then again, like I said, most people can be connectors. And that's actually one of the things that I wanted to do live in the bigger group. And so I hope by giving you all a little bit of time to brainstorm, you may have gotten to that question, like who are the type of people that you're trying to connect with? Because I'm wondering if there are people in this room who know exactly someone who would be helpful for you to connect with and fits that description. And so would people be willing to share who are some of the people you're trying to connect with? And we can open it up to the group to see if there are people who are willing to connect you to such folks. Yes? No? If people don't want to do that? Is there anyone in the audience who would like to share the type of person they're trying to connect with to see if there's someone in the audience who can connect them? Okay, I see a hand here. So we'll go ahead and start with that. So Tweezy wants to meet people who have found out what their passion is in social impact and found a way there. Raise your hand if you know someone who might fit that description. Okay, so I'm trying to think about what may be the best way to actually connect people, and so would it be useful to pause or have everyone here who raised their hand memorize this face? Come find her after the session. I may even leave some time at the end just so that people can connect, because I know there's a speaker in here right afterwards, right? Maybe, I think so. Okay, so I'm gonna build in time to make sure people can make those connections. Okay, so Tweezy's looking for someone, figured out their passion, social impact, has gone that path. All right, who else would like to make an ask? Of the audience. So maybe anyone who's had experience trying to get a population that hasn't worked with technology to adopt technology. Has anyone ever had to do that or know people who have done that? Sometimes it may not be necessarily like in the specific space, because and that's, again, like another practice, right? Learning what are some good ways to make your asks flexible, right? So if you're to put out the most ideal specific unicorn out there and you don't get hands, how might you broaden it until someone says, oh, yes, I think I know someone who might be able to shine a light on that? Okay. All right, like I said, I'm going to leave time at the end for people to make the connections with the people who were raising their hands. But there is one last thing that I wanted to talk about. Like I said, I'm here to try to help people move through the blocks that get in the way of being able to offer help, give help, ask for help, and receive help. And so we talked about, you know, what are the ways in which we may connect more effectively? What are the ways in which we can have deeper conversations or avoid the awkward, I don't know how I can help this person, or I don't know how this person can help me, by compiling a really flexible list of questions you can use. But another question that I inevitably get is around how to build your personal board of advisors. Raise your hand if you're familiar with that concept. Okay, so some. So maybe I'll explain it a little bit. How many of you have ever had a mentor or have mentored someone? How many of you have ever wanted a mentor? Okay. How many of you have heard about the difference between mentors and sponsors? So the difference between mentors and sponsors, again, mentors share a lot of information. Sponsors are actually people who will open doors for you, help you connect with opportunities, will go to bat for you. And so there's a lot of studies out there about how being able to incorporate these types of people into your lives can really amplify your ability to advance in your career. But a lot of people will ask, well, how do I get one of those? Or how do I ask someone to do that for me? And the thing is, it's not like this. I was running a workshop at Stanford with undergraduate students, and they were asking, like, how do I find mentors in the workplace if there's not an actual program? And I said, it's not actually through just asking this question. Because again, if you can imagine being on the receiving end of that, will you be my sponsor? Sometimes can be hard to say yes to because it may not be clear what that means. And so a more effective way of being able to cultivate a commitment to sustained action or sustained contact with someone who can really help you move forward is about being specific. And so I want each of you to think about, you know, what is the type of person you would love to have on your personal board of advisors? Like, who is someone who can either open doors for you? Or like, what would it look like to have someone who could provide you with the guidance that you're seeking at this point in time? And if you can't actually think of a name and a face for this person, again, think about characteristics, because then you may do those asks about, does anyone know someone who? Okay, so I want you to think, okay, if you could put someone on your personal board of advisors, who would it be? Or at least what type of person would they be? And then I want you to consider three things. One, what is the goal you would hope they can help you achieve? What is it that you would need from them in order for them to help you achieve that goal? And then lastly, how much of their time do you need? And so, oh yes. Sure. Absolutely. I love that, and it's worth repeating. So if I had a marker, I would add the fourth bullet of what is it that you could offer them? And it's interesting, because I was thinking about that, and I was thinking, should I include that, or would that be an intimidating thing? Because how many of you have ever felt like you didn't want to ask for something because you didn't know what it is that you could offer in exchange? I see some of these. Okay. So it is a worthwhile thing to think about. There may be interesting things that you may be able to offer. But I'd also say never forget, again, why someone may be willing to help you. I think everyone in this room raised their hand when I asked, if you could help someone in this room, would you? And I think everyone's hand went up. Now think about why that is. It feels good to be able to help someone. And so, yes, even after thinking through the question, is there something I can offer this person? Whether it is like information or just like, you know, being an advocate for them. Like being able to testify to their ability to mentor or help someone out. Or maybe it's other connections, like being able to make connections for them. At the end of the day, especially if you've had a lot of those conversations already where you've helped them be helpful to you, and even beyond that, helped them feel helpful, that's valuable in and of itself, right? That feeling of being able to help someone else. And so, again, I like making sure that people have time to think about these things and actually record their thoughts, because a lot can go on in the day of a conference, and I don't want these things to kind of like totter off somewhere. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes, again, just to brainstorm. If you were to walk out of here wanting to add one person to your personal board of advisors, who would it be? Like with name, face, or, you know, what would that person be like? And then these questions. Sure. Great. So the question was, who are the types of people that I might want to include in this list? And notice a lot of these things connect back to other things that we've talked about, right? So these are just four of the different types of people that you may want. So again, a role model, someone who is kind of like in the place that you want to be 5, 10 years from now. Someone who's an advisor, and this one's interesting because you can think about who could be a good personal advisor. Like, who is someone who is going to keep your interests at heart and be able to give you advice from that lens, as opposed to someone who may like have their own biases or their own like side motivations for the advice that they give you. Again, a maven or someone who's just like an expert, has their finger on the pulse of all of those things that you want to learn about. Connector, and then there are also a few roles that aren't here. So one is a peer, or like a truth-sayer. Like, who is someone that is going the same journey with you, who you can, you know, when things are tough, you can commiserate with, or when you're facing certain struggles, they're facing them with you as well, and you can have that dialogue. So who is a peer or a truth-sayer? Also, a cheerleader. Never underestimate the value of having just like a cheerleader who will cheer you on no matter what is happening, because sometimes things are rough and you need those cheerleaders in your life. Mine is sitting back there. And then lastly, another one that people sometimes forget about is a protege. So this is someone who's actually not ahead of you, but following your path. And something that's really interesting about having one of those people on your board is that so it'd be kind of like the type of person you would mentor. By having a protege on your board, it allows you to really crystallize the learnings that you've made over the course of your career. And so in addition to these, I would say a peer, so peer slash truth-sayer, a cheerleader, and then also a protege. Okay. All right, so let's go back to giving you, again, a little bit of time to brainstorm, because I am all about giving you ways to like be actionable after this workshop. Again, in the conference setting, sometimes there's just a lot of things going on, and I want to give you time to be able to sit, digest, figure out what you want to do next. So I'll give you 2 minutes to brainstorm about this, and then we'll bring it back to close, and then I might do Q&A or let people connect, okay? I wanted to sort of close by talking about this. So again, my intention was to provide a space for people to, one, digest what has been going on today, reflect on what it is that you had hoped to get out of today, identify maybe who are some of the connections that you want to make, what is it that you're seeking, what is it that you might ask for, and also what it is that you might offer folks. And so, I mean, the workshop ends in 10 minutes, but this journey that you each are on is not. There's still another session after this. There's a networking event tonight. And no doubt, I think I've already seen people pull out their phones and like exchange contact information. So I have a feeling there's going to be more conversations to come. But I'd love to hear just like a few shares from the audience. What is, in the spirit of putting something out there and actually saying you're going to do something so that you have more accountability in this group to get it done. I want to hear what is one thing that you're going to do when you walk out of this workshop. And I hope there are going to be a lot more of those connections and matches as people walk out of here. But like I said, I wanted to go ahead and reserve time for people to connect with the people who knew of other folks who could help the people who asked. And so I think in the next 7 minutes, I guess, well, before we do that, I'm going to put this here. If you're interested in additional resources, also if you wanted a copy of these slides, you can get them online. Just go to that link. If you have other specific questions, if you want to learn more about what I do, you can either email me or head to my website. But like I said, in the time that's left, I want everyone who had put out an ask of, you know, people they're trying to connect to, maybe like stand where you are, and people will remember where you were sitting, come find you. Otherwise, I'll also be down here to answer questions, and then I think as people start filtering in, I might move outside. Because I think there may have been some other questions that people may have wanted to ask, but maybe just in a one-on-one environment. All right? Do you feel like you got a lot out of this time? Good. That was my intention. So thank you for coming. And again, remember, it's not about me standing up here. There's a wealth of wisdom out there if we all just acknowledge what we can offer and ask for.